I've been entangled with Dennis for quite some time, as he was my PhD supervisor, so I'm really looking forward to see what he has to tell us about
identical
quantum particles.
Well, thank you very much. So I hope you can be heard.
You seem like you got it.
Is this better?
Yeah?
As soon as I'm no longer here, will then please warn me. So thank the organizers very much. I thank the organizers very much for not only for inviting me, but first of all for organizing this conference. I think it's exactly, you have to do something like this to honor here. Here is a very special physicist. Well, he mentioned in his remark just for the break that he has many hobby horses. And one of them has to do with another remark that was made this morning, that Geert likes to go into depth. He goes very deep in, not really in the U-boats, but the figurative purveyor of speaking. So he's special, I think, in the sense that, well, he of course is an eminent physicist, but he's also special in the sense that his range of interest is so broad, as I've already alluded to. And what I'm struck by is that he has an interest which is quite uncommon among theoretical physicists, namely in the philosophy and the foundations of physics. That is the interest of myself. And it's not just a hobby horse. I think it's too modest to say that, because Geert has actually written a book about the interpretation of quantum mechanics, which is partly visible here. He has his own interpretation of quantum mechanics, it's still the automaton interpretation. Actually, I do not agree with that interpretation. But we will not discuss that. But I'm very much attracted by the motivation here for writing this book. And in the words of the publisher, Springer, it's like this here. They say about Geert, dissatisfied with the uncomfortable gaps in the deconstruction of quantum mechanics meshes with the classical world, that Hoff has revived, not in the favor of theories, but in a much better way than it used to be done. Now, apart from the details, this motivation to be attentive to the clash that there is between classical physics and the world of experience and the structure of quantum mechanics, that's something that I like, very much affected by that. And that will also be the focus of this talk, but it will be much more modest than the big program that Geert embarks on in this book. I want to call attention to a very fundamental concept, both in classical mechanics and in quantum mechanics. It's really a very simple thing that I'm going to speak about. Maybe the concept of a particle. So let's first think a little bit about what classical particles are. So here I have a couple of typical classical particles. Clearly distinguishable. Each particle is characterized by a bundle, a set of properties, individual properties. And it never occurs in classical mechanics that two particles share exactly the same properties. In that case, suppose you think of an imaginary world in which objects could have exactly the same properties. Well, it would be doubtful, I think, whether you would be justified in speaking about particles at all in such a situation. Because the two things would coalesce and you would not speak about individual objects. Anymore. So that's a kind of paradigm case that classical physics offers us, the distinguishable objects, and this distinguishability is given by the properties, the different properties these objects have. Now, of course, we label the particles, but these labels do not add anything to the physics that already there. These labels are just a convenient way of giving names to the particles. And so if you switch particles in the sense that, so there is a situation one on top and in a situation to blow it down on this slide. And in both cases, there are two particles, a red one and a, what is it, the bluish one. Now suppose that I'm going to exchange properties, that all the properties that were first given to particle 1 are given to particle 2. Will that lead to a new situation? No, it will not. The only thing that's achieved by such an operation is that I switch the labels. I switch the labels, but in the conventional, it doesn't make any difference. So the state of classical particles is really permutation invariant in this sense, that I can switch the labels around to the data along. The labels do not have an independent physical content. Even on this very primitive, I would almost say, level, there is room for controversy. So some philosophers think that there is some kind of identity in particles that goes beyond the physical properties. There's even a Latin-like name for that, exeity, or ec in Latin, means primitive distance, that's the English translation. But I'm going to reject, I'm not going to discuss that. I think that's completely outside of the scope of physics. It's in conflict with the way physics operates to admit certain such non-physical properties. So I'm going to adhere to the point, to the view that objects in physics, and I'm speaking about physical physics here, are distinguished, individuated by physical properties and by nothing else. Well, that means in particular that if I have a couple of particles with the same intrinsic properties, I mean state independent properties, like particles of the same sort, let's think of electrons all having the same mass and electrical charge. And if I put them in their states in a phase diagram, in phase space, that there's this symmetry, permutation symmetry, and that means that I can go over to a reduced phase space. So this is a phase space, kind of symbolic representation of it, for two particles on one axis. I have the position and momentum of particle 1. On the other axis, I have the position and momentum of particle 2. And now I can switch the labels 1 and 2, but still keep the same physical situation as I discussed a moment ago. And in this picture, that corresponds to reflecting the point over this diagonal here in the picture. So, what I just argue is that this point here, so that represents two particles. So at some point, the represents two particles. Really simple here. It represents the same physical situation as this point here. And that motivates, well, shrinking the phase space, scrapping this part and only keeping this. Well, if you're only interested in the physical differences, that's don't think that's relevant. So these points are then identified. So if you're discussing in classical physics particles of the same sort, it's very reasonable to go over to this reduced phase space. Now I've been discussing the interchange of two particles, but that was an interchange in thought. The only thing that I did was shift the labels between the particles, change the labels between the particles. And that should be distinguished, sharply distinguished, from a physical operation that you can think of. Namely, if you start at a certain point in time with two particles here, and they change places or change properties by some kind of evolution process. That can be represented, sometimes a physical process that can be represented in this picture. So if you were working with the unreduced phase space, then this bluish line represents such an interchange. So first the two particles were here, and now after some evolution, they end up here. But the same thing can be represented, of course, in the reduced phase space. And you can recognize, even in this reduced phase space, in this identification, that there has been a physical interchange between the two particles, because these interchange processes, even in the reduced phase space, have special characteristics. So they touch this diagonal, and then there's a kink, lack of differentiability of the trajectory there. So even in the reduced phase space, you can see that the interchange has the physical sense. Now, there's something peculiar in classical physics, something really important, and that is that particles have trajectories. Actually, I made use of that in the picture at the moment ago. And that means that, if I know something about the initial situation, for instance, that this reddish particle was at x1 at an initial point of time, and then the other one was here, then I can still, on the basis of this history, in principle distinguish between the situation that the two particles are like this here, or the other way around. I was looking at the different trajectories they have followed. So there may be, in spite of this perturbation invariance, there may be physical differences between the two situations on the basis of the history. And sometimes this justifies, in classical physics, even in the case of so-called identical particles, or particles with the same intrinsic properties, this justifies using the unreduced phase space. Because, in a situation like this, in the initial situation like this, you can reach this situation in two different ways. One going here, and the other going there, or the other way here. Yeah. Now, this seems all very elementary, and without any physical consequences. But actually, there are even practical consequences of this. This I will not discuss, just pointing out that they are there, and that has to do with certain entropy calculations. So many of you will be familiar with the so-called Gibbs paradox. That is a discussion of a situation in which you have two containers with a partition between them that separates them. You have one gas in one container, another gas in the other. And now the partition is drawn out, and the gases start to mix. Now, if the two gases are different, that will lead to more, elementally speaking, leads to more chaos than there was in the beginning, because now the particles on the left-hand side, the bluish one there, and after the partition of the container, can go to the right-hand side and can fulfill the whole volume. And so the entropy grows. If you make a calculation on the basis of Boltzmann's formula, that's the result. But now think of the same situation if you have particles of the same sort. Now it becomes a little bit moot whether the situation at the end is more complicated than the situation in the beginning because of this permutation invariance argument that he just gave you. And some people say that if I forget about the colors, if I do this experiment with particles of the same sort, there will be no entropy growth in the case of mixing. Because it's the same situations before and after the drawing out of the partition can be realized. That would be the instantaneous view, so to speak, on the basis of the reduced phase space. If you think in terms of these histories and the unreduced phase space, actually there is a growth of chaos and entropy. And that is will surprise you because it's such an elementary case. This is actually the subject of a discussion that has been going on for a very long time and that is still very much alive. I had a discussion with this in a paper just published a year ago, the Simon Saunders from Oxford. But I'm not going to discuss it. I just wanted to point out that there are certain consequences of how you deal with this permutation invariance, with the concept of identical particles. So, even in classes, so what's the upshot of this introductory discussion? In classical physics, particles are always characterized by a bundle of properties. We inject something coming beyond that. If you have particles of the same sort, the state is permutation invariant. But still, you can assign labels on the basis of these bundles of properties. And sometimes these labels also have a dynamical interpretation and dynamical content because of the concept of interactivity. Now, my main subject here is quantum mechanics. And so let's swiftly go over to the situation in quantum mechanics. So I'm going to discuss identical particles. Well, the word identical here is the way that I use it in the way physicists use the word identical. In philosophy, two things are only identical if they're one and the same. Which most philosophers do only accept that, the use of the term. But in physics, people speak about identical particles if they only have their intrinsic properties, the state independent properties, the same. So all electrons, all protons, they are identical in this physicist's parlance. Now, there's an important principle in quantum mechanics that says that if you have a state of identical particles, two or more identical particles, this state should be either symmetrical, or anti-symmetric. So these are the permutation descriptions that are very basic in quantum mechanics. So you can never have a state which is just a product of two non-particle states. If you had such a product, well, then you would be very close to classical physics, because then you could say particle one is the particle designated, denoted by this first state, if you have the product in the two particle state, and particle two is the particle corresponding to this second factor in the product. But that equation never occurs in quantum mechanics. You only have these symmetrical or anti-symmetrical states. And here I have an example I've taken, yes, that's for the sake of illustration. I've taken a symmetrical one, and to have kind of connection with what done before, I've had two states that represent colors. There's a greenish particle, and yet we had one. But now there's an important observation to make. So these labels that are here, okay, what do they mean? Well, it's standard in textbook quantum mechanics to say that these refer to the particles, particle one and particle two, and that this is their state. But if you think about it a little bit, that means an enormous deviation from what we argued before, namely that particles are characterized by their properties. Because these labels, one and two, are not connected to either team or yet. They're, well, huffing between the two, both team and yet have equal shares of one and two. So, formally speaking, completely mathematical speaking, it's quite clear what is H1 and H2 mean. They are the labels of the vector Hilbert spaces in the total product Hilbert space in which the two particle system, its state is defined. But conceptually, if you want to know what kind of physical thing, or is there a physical thing these labels refer to, that's not so clear. Because if they cut what I say, there is not one property which you would like to associate a particle with which the labels are associated. And if you become a little bit more technical about that, then that can be translated in the following statement. Namely that if you think of these states 1 and 2, these labels 1 and 2 as referring to particles, and you are going to compute the state for these particles, then all these states will be exactly the same. That's by taking a partial trace in the total many particle. So W1 and W2, under the textbook interpretation, refer to the state of particle 1 and particle 2, and all these states are the same. So this easily generalizes to many, many, many more particles. So this is quite the general feature, having nothing to do with the specific example of two particles. Now think a little bit about this. Do we want this? Do we think this is acceptable? I would say no. It's really bizarre to think that these labels defined in this way refer to particles. Because then all these particles, if you think that the quantum mechanical description is complete, possess exactly the same properties. That would mean, for example, that if I think of electrons, all the electrons in the universe, that I cannot distinguish them in any way, and that, for instance, it doesn't make any sense to say, to make a distinction between the electrons in this room, or perhaps the electrons in my body, as opposed to the electrons outside my body. All systems have exactly the same properties. That's very far away from the way the concept of a particle is used, also in physical practice, in intuition, and speaking, but also in physical situations. I will say more about that later. A very important consequence of this is that if you look at the classical limit of quantum mechanics, well, what would you expect from such a limit, and what would you desire from such a limit? That the things that occur on the classical side, with particular particles, in the limiting case would become closer and closer to classical particles. Of course, quantum particles are different, they have different properties and in the fields and whatever. But you would expect that in the classical limit the distance becomes smaller and smaller. But that can never be the case. These quantum particles, whatever limit I take, whatever procedure I apply to the formula, always, because of these synchronization postulates, always keep exactly the same space. And so they can never become distinguishable objects like we are used to in classical mechanics. So that motivates the idea that we should look for a way to view this quantum formalism and to define particles in it that's different from the standard way in which these labels are associated with particles. So here I have a situation in which you would not feel that need. Suppose I have a state psi of this form. So now I take an anti-symmetrical state. That's the most important case, that those are fermions. And these, as we shall illustrate, have the best chance of becoming particles. So this is an anti-symmetrical state, and I now to become a little bit more physical, I think of a very state of one particle state that's confined to a very small region on the left, and here I have a particle state, one particle state that's confined to a small region on the right. So the individual products are of a one particle state here and a one particle state there. And because of the synchronization postulate, I have to synchronize. These are electron systems. I have to anti-synchronize them. Now, what's the intuitive meaning of this? That is a particle on the left and a particle on the right. And actually, that's what's done also in physics, in standard physics, in discussions of, for instance, the Einstein-Rosen paradox, where you have a state of this kind. I will show you the exact state in a moment. The discussion is always in terms of a particle on the left and a particle on the right. Well, physicists in their daily practice always speak about particles here and there and so on. But note that that cannot be justified on the basis of the standard doctrine that he's saying forbids these same physicists to learn their quantum mechanics, because they're the particles on the same state. But if you go a little bit deeper in the technicalities, you will see that a state like this in many respects mimics the behavior of classical two-particle systems in which you have one system on the left and one system on the right. But in order to get that information, we have to inject the idea that these factor labels are the labels of particles. So, what's the general proposal? In line with what I explained a moment ago, instead of taking the labels as indicating the particles, referring to particles, I'm going to take the states, the L and the R states here, to distinguish and individuate department. So that's a kind of general proposal, and I should note at this point that the first time this was proposed, to my knowledge, that this was in a master thesis by a student of mine, and he is Andrea Lubberding, who happens to be in the audience here. These are not original ideas of myself, but they go back to this this idea of master student. So what's the idea? So he made these individuating states, he distilled them out these many particle states, and the benefits of that, I claim, is that this gives an intuitively acceptable picture. Is in accordance with how particles are discussed in physical practice. So it's not just a philosophical exercise, it's it tailors very well with physical practice. And, very important, it allows for a satisfactory classical limit in which you would expect, if you take this classical limit, that this would tend to a situation or the description of the situation in which we have one particle on the left and one on the right. And as I said, that can never be done if we believe that these labels tell you what particles are. There's a downside, perhaps. Actually, I think it's also a positive side of the whole program. If you follow this program, as we shall see, then it turns out that particles are not fundamental in quantum mechanics, that only in special situations the concept of a particle is applicable at all. And of course, as we get closer to the classical limit, this concept will become more and more applicable. But quite generally speaking, in quantum mechanics, the concept of a particle will prove not to be fundamental. It's rather emergent theme that also occurs. The theme of emergence is also occurs this morning. So let's become a little bit more technical, but because there's not so much time, and because it's not so important, I will call it very quickly. There's a formalism, and it was first introduced by Hugh Harvey and in a joint paper with Marinato and David 2002. He observes that if you have states of the kind I have here, it is a product state on which you have applied this procedure of anti-synergization. So it's a very special state, it's a synergized product state. If you have a state like that, so a synergized an anti-synergized product state, it has certain properties which are very close to the properties of product states themselves. And actually there's a mathematical tool that you can use here, the tool of the so-called batch product, that is not batch, that you see here. And so this anti-synergized state, that's the usual way of reacting states in quantum mechanics, can be written alternatively in these terms. And if you do that, then you see they go very close to what you actually want, and what the natural implication of the state would be. Namely, you can say, well, this state is composed of one component in state A and another in state E. So that would make it easy to give a particle interpretations. And then this is something that generalizes to the animate particle state. So there's this paper by Giardi, Marinotto, and Weber. Andrea Lubberding and myself have written a paper on this. Later, the topic is also has been taken on the others, especially by Adam Fulton in Oxford, who also has appeared in more recent papers about this, and who has introduced the term factorism for the standard doctrine in quantum mechanics, in which you use the factor labels of the quantum field spaces as particle labels. So he is an anti-factorist, as I am myself. That's always good. It's good to blame on someone else. These what are the nice features of them? Well, as I already pointed out, there's a natural way of discerning component systems in these many particle states. You can label these particles on the basis of their different properties. I'm thinking here of fermions, and then it turns out that these states are always different. Bosons is a more difficult case. And I think the best occasion this other concept is not in general applicable. And there's another thing, namely that in the typical Bell situation, the EPR situation, in which you have a localized state here and a localized state there, and the sink with the spin state and the whole thing synchronized. I'll have it in detail on my slides. Well, in those states, in the EPR state, Bell inequalities are violated, so that's a sign that there's something not classical going on. But these wedge states never do so. So they cannot violate Bell inequalities in the case of EPR situation. So I more or less already discussed that. Oh yeah, well, there's one important additional thing. If you have a wedge state of this kind, or to make it very colorful, I've colored my particles here. If there's free evolution, these particles, thus defined, even have a trajectory. Well, it doesn't need to be a space-time trajectory, but a trajectory in tilted space, because orthogonal states in unitary evolution always remain orthogonal with respect to each other. So even the concept of a trajectory comes back. I'm not saying that it's universally valid, but in certain situations it will become applicable. So this, perhaps these all seem more or less trivial points. It's all very elementary. But still, one should note that this is in direct conflict with how the subject is discussed in Monte Carlo's textbooks, where it is said it's maintained that particles in general do not have trajectories, and moreover that all these states are the same. Now, this is only part of the story, because I already said that if you go this way, then you come to the conclusion that the particle concept is not generally applicable. The situations that I discussed in this particle concept of self, it's because very special case. Namely, if you have this product, this wedge product, and that means in ordinary terms that you have a synergized product state. But not all states in quantum mechanics have that form. And here is one example of a state which cannot be written as a synchronized or anti-synchronized state. And this is this EPR state, which I already mentioned a couple of times. Usually, this EPR state is discussed only in terms of its spin part, the single state that we have here. But in order to get a full description, we should also include the spatial piece of freedom. And that's done here in this symmetrical spatial part. So again, I'm thinking here of two narrow wave functions, one on the left and one on the right. Now, in this state, you cannot give an easy particle interpretation. Because if you think of it, what was the crux, the core of this particle interpretation? That you bind particle properties together in one state. So you a spin property and a spatial property and perhaps another property. Like if you are able to combine them into one particle state, then you can actually speak about the particle with that property. But that's not applicable in this case, because the spin part here is completely independent. As you see, this is a product state, but not of one particle components. The spin, the single state, is completely independent of the spatial part. So if anything, you could say that whether you're on the left or on the right, the single state is there in the same way. It's completely independent of where you are. And so here you cannot combine a spin property with a spatial property. And in particular, you cannot say there's a particle on the left with a certain spin value and a particle on the right with a certain spin value. In a state like this, so we need to discover a kind of criterion of particality, if that word exists, as a particle group. In a state like this, it's completely different because, as you can see, the left in both terms of this superposition, the left part combines with plus, also plus, and right with minus, so that indicates a spin relation. And so in this state, we do have, we can write this as a wedge product, so we do have that it's a symmetrized anti-product. It's an anti-symmetrized product state. And the, if you write it as a wedge product, then the factors that occur in the wedge product are, where is all that?
15 minutes, and oh, okay. Inclusive discussion.
Okay. So this can be interpreted as a two-participating parity system. But again, the price to pay for that is that the indices, the labels here, do not refer to particles. Now, I spoke about this classical limit, and I should point out that if you follow this path, there's a way, very similar way, of seeing that if processes like decoherence play a part, it's universally considered to be a very important criterion of the classical limit, the particularity will emerge in a certain way. So in the top line here, or the top end of the equation, I have state this is not interpretable as a particle state, as two particles each with their own state. But if this lives in an environment, this interacts with the particles, and it must be an environment that's sensitive to position and to spin, then you get something like this. So the environment responds differently to the plus and the minus terms, so you get this, and then via the usual discussion of incoherence, it becomes possible to say that this, at least for observations performed on this state, has all the properties of either the particle state of this kind or particle state of this kind. So in both cases, you can speak about particles that have a well-defined position plus a well-defined spin in a certain direction. So, rounding off this part, perhaps I will skip the rest to have more discussion. So what's my conclusion about particles in classical mechanics and quantum mechanics? Well, in classical mechanics, particles are really fundamental. These are the basic building blocks of it. The classical mechanics is which classical mechanics deals. So these are really fundamental things. They are always distinguishable. Usually on many counts, but at least by their different positions. Now in quantum mechanics, the equation is completely different. The usual textbook approach makes something very strange from the concept of a particle. I think there's another way of doing it, that's the way I have explained here. But if you follow that road, then the conclusion is that in quantum mechanics, an integrating in terms of particles is only applicable in certain situations. If you have these wedge states of things that approach or are indistinguishable, you can say that means of equilibrium and things like that. So in quantum mechanics, particles become emergent. So the concept in the most general situation is not applicable at all. If the concept is applicable, then quantum particles correspond to orthogonal one-particle states, rather than these particle labels that I in time. And as we have seen, if that's the case, if the particle picture is completely applicable, so that means if there are these wedge states, then the things, the usual, the striking problem features, like violation of building rules and vulnerability, do not occur. So you could turn that around, and you could say that in the situations where these typical quantum features become prominent, violations of vulnerability, then that's a sign that the classical particle concept is no longer applicable. And actually, if you look at the situations like the EPR situation from this angle, then a completely different analysis becomes plausible, in which you don't start with a particle here and a particle there. And you ask yourself, how is it possible that the particle there feels something from the things that I do here? That's the standard way of discussing the EPR situation. But if you don't think that particles, localized particles, are there at all in this situation, another way of discussing the EPR situation becomes possible, of which you could perhaps say that it is local, but not in the classical sense, but in the quantum sense. I have some more slides about that, but because of the discussion, I would like to stop here.
Thank you. Yes, Ms. Zaya.
Okay, thank you for the talk.
Please wait, so I can actually throw this. That's the whole idea of why is it too soft and everything.
Is it now? Yeah.
Is it turned on? Is it switched on?
Yeah,
maybe you should speak in the jam.
You can just put it right up here. The black bar right up to your
phone. Find someone who's talking that.
Easy.
No, cool.
Nice. Well, thank you for the talk. I wanted to ask, what makes the particles distinguishable is their positions, right?
Their what?
Their positions.
In classical physics.
But in quantum,
not only, I would say, but yeah.
In your quantum mechanics characterization of distinguishability, you have different position for each particle.
No, that doesn't need to be the case. So I have orthogonal states in Hilbert space. Those distinguishable particles. So it is more general.
In the wedge product,
yes.
You say you can follow trajectories?
Yeah, in Hilbert space.
In Hilbert space, okay.
In general. So, but I would like to have in the classical case, of course, there's a limiting case in which things do have positions.
Okay,
and so that needs a separate discussion.
The labels of your wedge product do not include the different positions of the particles?
They may, but they need not.
And how then can they be distinguishable in which way?
Because two orthogonal states are distinguishable.
Okay, maybe we can make
them. Oh, yeah, but yeah, they can do a test whether it's in one or the other. So it becomes much more abstract, of course, than the classical picture. But it gives a kind of access to a classical limit. So this should be complemented with some analysis in which you show that position in the classical limit becomes very important. And I think that can be done actually by means of dynamical arguments, the decoherence and so on. Potentials that are position dependent. Then you get something like what they had on one of these slides, the gross decoherence. And the different components which decohere with each other are more or less confined in position.
But we have a wedge product, and then you have some kind of evolution, and then it represents and it creates like a mixture of particle states. And can a mixture of particle states also evolve into a wedge product again? Actually, back.
Well, I did not say that the wedge product evolves into a mixture, so a pure state never evolves into a mixture, unless you neglect part of it. So the idea of decoherence is not that a pure state, so So in this context, at least, I'm not speaking about black holes and stuff. But in this context, a pure state never becomes nature, not even if there's the coherence. But if you look at only part of the system, so forget about this environment, then you don't see coherence between the different parts of that state. So in that sense, there's this kind of de facto or practical, for practical purposes, transition to a mixed state. But it's not really a mixed state. And so a mixed state can never become pure.
There's one question behind you. Three rows beyond. You can actually throw it.
Thank you.
I hope you can hear me.
Yes.
You did your definitions of superposition in configuration space. What happens if you do that in Fourier space?
In what?
You define your superposition in Fourier space.
Fourier?
You have states and configuration space in terms of position. And in Fourier space, you have states defined as frequencies, as energies.
Well, I'm not quite sure whether I get your question, but the picture of classical physics, that it was phase space.
That
and the points were labeled by position and momentum.
And momentum.
And momentum. So the Fourier analysis was, of course, from position to momentum.
Thank you. There's a question over there.
Throw it. Come on. You can do it.
Yeah, I like it.
He can do it.
Thank you. Just a possibly technical question. So when you work with any particle, quantum state usually construct something called a Fock space.
Yes.
So I just want to know, is this wedge product construction equivalent to a Fock space representation, or are there some differences?
Yes. So my discussion was in the context of quantum mechanics.
That is
old fashioned quantum mechanics. The Fock space is a field theory, of course.
No, you can do a Fock space construction also in normal quantum mechanics. It's just that you have normal ladder operators that create particles, and it's a similar way of teasing out which particle is what.
Yeah, well, so I would say that I'm thinking about this in two theoretical terms, but of course you can also do it the other way, you can call it quantum mechanics. The picture which I sketch here is very similar to the Fock space formalism. And especially this idea that the particle concept is not always applicable also comes out in this Fock space formalism, where you have a state which is excited in an n-fold way. But it doesn't make much sense to speak about individual particles in that state. So that's where you have the implication of bosons, because I didn't discuss but I think this is in complete agreement with the Fock space theory. No conflict there.
Any other questions? Oh, there's one here.
Yeah. Yes.
The only chance in life if you ever get it, throwing something at the Nobel Prize.
Is that a fundamental distinction or a gradual distinction between classical and quantum in this respect?
Gradual. Well, that's a fundamental distinction, but there's a gradual transition between the two. Because you can have that many properties are bound together, so a position and a spin and perhaps something else, and then some other properties not. And then, strictly speaking, the particle concept is not fully applicable. But as long as you don't do anything with these degrees of freedom that, well, I'm disturbing, I'm spoiling the activities, then the whole thing behaves as a particle system. Actually, that's the reason, perhaps, that many people speak about a particle here and a particle there in the EPR context. because of course there is not a particle in definite spin coefficient even and a particle definite spin coefficient there. But if you only look at spatial part of the wave function, well that part, that can be interpreted as something left and something right.
In my book, which you just briefly mentioned, I introduced an operator, which is the Earth, Mars, and the interchange operator. So it puts Earth or Mars is and Mars or Earth is. So now you can have two possible states, there's a minus and there's a plus sign. And the point is these things are officially measurable, but in practice, of course, not.
So perhaps there is some kind of relation between us.
Other questions, perhaps, or if not, then perhaps we could. Oh wait, there is one, Jeremy.
I have a small, quick question. Could you clarify for me, Dennis? What about the case when you take little a, little b, not orthogonal, and then you anti-symmetrize that?
Yeah, but then they're not really distinguishable. Okay. So in the fermion case, that never occurs. So in the fermion case, if you start with arbitrary A's and B's, products and symmetries, it can always be written in terms of orthogonal states. In the boson case, that's not so. But that's a drama for the particle concept, actually. And then it's better to discuss in terms of Fock state and Fock state.
Okay. Any other questions or comments? About the identical particles? It's there now, so.
They are distinguishable.
If not, then perhaps we should have lunch now. We'll meet again here at 13:40, so 20 minutes towards 1, 2, I'm sure. So 1 hour for lunch. Now, and the lunch is over here, right outside the building.